Shout!
Marlene, you told me to keep you awake. We're going to get to shout. First, I need to tell a story. There's an old Jewish legend that goes something like this. God created the heavens and the earth, and it was magnificent in all of its glory, the mountains and the stars above, the entire universe, the oceans. And God went to the heavenly host, the angels, and said, okay, what do you think of it? And the angels stood back in awe and wonder. They said, God, it's magnificent. It's glorious. It's beautiful. Except for one thing. And God said, well, what's that? And they said, there's no praise. There's no singing to be heard. And so at once God moved with a mighty act and created the birds that sing, the wind that whispers, the murmuring of the oceans, and then God created humankind, you and me, with the desire in our hearts to praise God. And so the legend ends. A fitting legend for our lesson today, our continued study of the Psalms, isn't it? Especially Psalm 100. Psalm 100 is a call for you and me to adore God, to praise God, to worship God. In fact, many imagine the background to this psalm is one of a psalm of approach, a psalm of procession, or a psalm of entrance. Some think that this was used as the Jews frequently entered the temple. Can you imagine them singing these words, this psalm leading them as they entered the temple? Here they process up and they say, shout to the Lord, all the earth. And so keep that in mind, that the Jewish people, and we're invited to be a part of them, that we're in this heavenly procession, we're in this earthly procession, going up to the temple of God, entering into the presence of God, and we're using this psalm as our procession. C.S. Lewis captures all this so well. The sort of attitude that should be a part of your heart and my heart each and every Sunday as we enter into the presence of God. He says these words. He says, all enjoyment spontaneously overflows into praise. The world rings with praise. Lovers praising one another, readers their favorite poet, walkers praising the countryside, players praising their favorite game. The delight is incomplete until it is expressed. The delight is incomplete until it is expressed. That's what our psalm is inviting you and me to do. It's inviting us to express our delight, to give word, to give voice to it, to sing it. In fact, invite is too weak of a word. Our psalm, this Psalm 100, is literally commanding you and me to worship and to praise. The seven verbs there, we could almost call them the magnificent seven. The seven verbs there are imperative. They're commands. The psalmist is saying, do this. It's not an option. It's something that he's commanding you and me to do. And so he begins with that command. Shout to the Lord, all the earth. That word for shout is one verb in Hebrew, and it's used in many different ways. Others say, make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. It's used in a positive way. It means to blow a trumpet as a king or queen is processing or coming into a town. It means a caller going forth before a king or a queen or some event calling forth for the people to gather. So it has that positive meaning, but it also has a negative meaning. It can mean somebody yelling out in distress or somebody calling words of warning from the walls and saying, watch out. Something bad is approaching. It can have either of those meanings. Of course, in our text, it has a positive meaning. The psalmist is saying, shout. Make a joyful noise to the Lord. One modern translator says it should really be rendered this: make a ruckus to the Lord. When was the last time our church made a ruckus in worship, huh? When was the last time we made a joyful noise? Now, I like that joyful noise because for those of us who can't sing it, it gives us permission to just make a noise, Jeff. We don't have to sing with great delight. We can make a ruckus. There's not a person here who can't make a ruckus. And the psalmist is telling you and me to make a ruckus to the Lord. Shout to the Lord, all the earth. Now in that procession, some commentators imagine that the Jews would turn from the temple and they would shout. And they would shout it to all the earth. It's almost an invitation, a commandment for all of the earth, not just for the Jewish people, but for all of the earth to shout to the Lord. And so the psalmist begins with that command. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Now worship has a connotation of work to it. In fact, many translations say, serve the Lord with gladness. You see, sometimes entering into God's presence requires a little work, a little effort on our parts. We sometimes think, especially in modern times, that worship is all about me. In fact, in the modern mindset of entertainment, it's almost like Jeff and I are the entertainers and you are there to be entertained. But that's not what's meant here. Serve the Lord with gladness. There's a work to worship. In fact, liturgy means the work of the people. It means we come together to work at worship. It should be something we endeavor, that we concentrate on, that at sometimes might require a little effort of us. Well, you can say, well, Pastor, that's no fun. Work isn't fun. Who said worship's supposed to be fun? It's supposed to be meaningful. It's supposed to offer God our praise, but it's not necessarily supposed to be fun. The image that came to mind as I was thinking of this, worship the Lord with gladness, serve the Lord with gladness, was the story many of us are familiar of Eric Liddell from Chariots of Fire. How many of us remember that movie? There's that great scene where his sister is asking him about running. And of course, he's facing that quandary, whether he should just do full-time mission work or whether running can be a form of worship. And he says to his sister basically these words. He says, but when I run, I feel alive. I feel like God is at my back, pushing me along. His running was a form of worship. Similarly for you and me, we should worship. Enter into it with that kind of mindset, and we should worship with gladness. Worship with gladness. Now when we're worshiping with gladness, is this a way worship with gladness looks? Thank you, Lord. Praise you, Lord. Praise you, Lord. Gladness implies that we should smile. Be something we delight, as the Dell did in running. It should be something that's joyous. Charlie, when you were playing football, it was like a form of worship, wasn't it? You were out there enjoying yourself. I could see Charlie coming around the end with a big smile on his face. That's the way we should approach worship. That it's something we do with gladness. You ever wonder why, in study after study, one of the reasons that's always near the top of the list why people don't attend church is they say that worship is boring. Our worship shouldn't be boring. We should worship with gladness. We should shout to the Lord with all the earth, and we should worship the Lord with gladness. And then our psalmist continues with our third of the magnificent sin. We should come before him with joyful song. Others say we should come into his presence with joyful singing. Now that word for presence or come before him literally is face in Hebrew. Because when you come to someone, you meet them face to face, when you see their face, you know you're in their presence. So imagine yourself, imagine our worship, how it would change if each and every Sunday we imagined Jesus was standing right here before us and we were interacting face to face. That's the image I have in mind. enter into his presence, come before his face with joyful singing. If Jesus was standing here, nothing more could be done by you and me than to simply fall on our knees in praise. Isn't that what you'd do if Jesus was standing here? That's the image the psalmist is saying. Enter into his presence with joyful singing. I was thinking of our plane trip back. There was a mother with a baby in the airplane. And you know, babies get that, don't they? When they see the face of mom or dad or grandpa or grandma, and they see the face, what do? They just light up, don't they? And they smile. That is something like the way you and I should approach worship. Enter into his presence with joyful singing. We should sing it with praise. It should be a joyful event, not a boring event. The psalmist is inviting, he's commanding you and me, and then he kind of switches gears. He says, know that the Lord is God. It is he who has made us, and the best translations also add, and not we ourselves. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Now that word know, we know is important because we've seen it time and again as we've worked our way through Psalms and other passages, that know is the most intimate kind of knowledge. In the Bible it's used of the kind of knowledge that a husband and wife have. Often the Bible says, and he knew her and she knew him. That's the know there. It's rich. But the psalmist says, know that the Lord is God. Now, why does he say that? Why does he say that? Because it seems like halfway through the psalm, the psalmist realizes that you and I have a big temptation. In fact, it may be the biggest temptation humanity has, and that is to think that you and I are in control. That is to make ourselves God. We live in a culture that's all about that, don't we? About the self-made man. It's about my life and my accomplishments. And the psalmist realizes if we put ourselves on the pedestal, then we're going to end up worshiping something else. That's why I struggled for years in the Old Testament. Always God was busting the chops of the Israelites over idolatry. And I often thought, well, we don't have any statues around. Why is he always worried about idolatry? And then I realized, well, an idol just isn't a statue. There are lots of things we make idols of, even if we don't erect a statue, don't we? In our culture, what are some of the things we make idols of? Our careers. How many of us put our whole meaning, our whole lives, it's like we worship our careers, or our accomplishments, or beauty in our culture? Isn't that a god? Or sex. For how many people in our culture is sex an idol, or popularity, or security, and all sorts of things like that. When God is not at the center, then our worship is going to turn toward these other things. And we're not going to be able to worship God wholeheartedly. We're not going to be able to worship God with joy, because God is going to be a threat to those other gods in our lives. That's why the psalmist says, know that the Lord himself is God. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who has made us and not we ourselves. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. What a beautiful image Jesus draws on that. I am the good shepherd. We know from Psalm 23rd, the 23rd Psalm, the importance of God as a shepherd. He was a shepherd of Israel. It's a powerful image, but it also reminds you and me that God has to be at the center of our worship. That our knowledge of God shapes and forms the way that we're able to worship, and how we're able to worship, and what we worship. In researching my sermon, I was taken aback when I discovered this fact. Our word thanks comes from the Anglo-Saxon root word for a thought. Thanks comes from the root thought. Now let me explain. Think about it. Thankfulness is essentially thoughtfulness. When we think correctly about ourselves and the world, we are then thankful for the gift of life and the beauty of the world around us. When the psalmist thinks about his life, when he thinks about his relationship with God, he is thoughtful. He is thankful. And he breaks out in praise and worship, and the praise and gratitude just bursts forth for the rest of the psalm. See, sometimes we got to get this thing screwed on right before our singing and our praise and our worship comes out right. We need to know the God that we worship in order to truly worship the God that we believe is there. The psalmist reminds you of me, and he breaks out in praise after he gets his thoughts right, doesn't he? It says, enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Remember the ancient cities, they all had gates. So you can imagine the people going into the gates, enter them with thanksgiving and the courts. Remember there were all those courts, and with the temple, there was the outer court, the inner court, and then there was the Holy of Holies. So the images, they're entering into the Holy of Holies, those courts and those gates, and as they go through them, they are singing thanksgiving and they are offering up their praise. Give thanks to him, he continues. And praise, or other translations say, bless his name. Remember, to know the name of anyone in the ancient world was to know that person personally. The name meant so much more than names do for us. To know the name of God. In fact, God's name was so sacred that Jews would not even say it out loud. In fact, we don't even know what the name really is in Hebrew anymore, because Hebrew didn't write down consonants, and because they quit speaking the name, the real pronunciation has been lost. That's how sacred God's name was. The psalmist is saying, bless the name. And then he continues, for the Lord is good. How often do we need to hear that? John Greenleaf Whittier said, within the maddening maze of things, when tossed by storm and flood, to one fixed trust my spirit clings, I know that God is good. God is good. We need to remember that. Especially when we're going through trials and tribulations, and if we're not going through them now, we likely will someday. Remember, through it all, God didn't bring that upon you 9 chances out of 10. It is simply a part of this sinful world, and that God is good. Don't forget it. God is good. For God is good, and his steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness is extended to all generations. Desmond Tutu said these words. He said, praise and worship of God will continue forever because we will always be discovering new aspects of God's goodness, greatness, and beauty. We are finite and God is infinite, so there shall forever be more of God to celebrate, discover, and worship. That's why in Revelations, they're just praising God all the time. It's like an ongoing worship service up there. They're praising God. It's no wonder that the Westminster Shorter Catechism asks this question of the catechism, of those who are going through catechism. They ask, what is the chief end of humans? And the response should be, the chief end of humans is to glorify God and to enjoy him forever. All this raises some tough questions for us, doesn't it? I need to ask them of myself. I need to ask them of each of us here. How important is worship for you and for me? Really, how important is it? Do we make it a priority? Do we work at it? Do we see it as something we must do as a command? Or do we see it as kind of an option? Well, if I feel like it, I'm going to worship today. If I don't feel like it, I'm not going to worship today. Do we view worship as something that just should be fun? Or do we view it as something we must do because it just gurgles up from the very depths of our soul? When was the last time we lost ourselves in worship? I mean, you just totally lost yourself. Lost track of time. Sang the words just as an expression of your soul, not even thinking about them. Or if you're like me, how often in worship you got all these things spinning around in the background? Something like, pastor, you're taking a lot of time here. Well, what about that pot roast back home? Boy, I got to get that grass mowed. On and on, instead of focusing on God and offering him worship that he deserves. When was the last time we totally focused on God when we authentically authentically worship God with our minds, not wandering or thinking about all those other worries and concerns. The psalmist says, well, shout! Woke you up, Betty Jane, again. To the Lord. All the earth, worship the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with joyful singing. Know that the Lord is God and he has created us and not we ourselves. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Thank the Lord and bless his name, for he is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations. Understand, Jeff, J.S. Bach, John Sebastian Bach, would begin all of his compositions with these simple letters. You begin them all with these simple Latin words. Jesu, Juva. Begin many of his compositions with those words in the corner. Jesu, Juva, which means Jesus help me. And then at the end of all of his compositions, or at least many of his compositions, he'd end with these words. Soli Deo Gloria. To God alone be the glory. What an image for us. What if each day we woke up and said, Jesus, help me? And at the end of each day we said, to you be the glory. What if every time we entered those doors we said, Jesus, help me to see your face. Help me to enter into your presence with joyful singing. And at the end of our worship, as Tom snuffed out those candles, we could really say, to God, the glory has been given. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Gracious and loving Lord, boy, we fall short when it comes to worshiping you. And Lord, we thank you for reminding us that we worship so many other things, and that to you and to you alone deserves our worship and our praise. Help us as a church and as individuals to work at our worship, to approach it with gladness, to imagine entering into your presence, to give you all the glory and all the honor that you alone deserve. Lord, we want to be a worshiping people. We want Asbury to be a place where people encounter you in worship. And so help us to do so, Lord. As the psalmists have directed us, help each of us to take our worship of you seriously and to enter into it joyfully and with thanksgiving. This is our heart's prayer, and Lord, we shout it in the precious name of Jesus Christ.